Good morning. It is good that our God has gathered us this morning, that we may worship him together as a community. And I would like to thank you for inviting me here as well. My name is Ryan VanderWees. You may have seen that in your bulletin. I went to Calvin Seminary and I got my MDiv, and I'm currently at Puritan Reformed Seminary up on Leonard on the north side of town doing further studies. And I am thankful that you've brought me here this morning to fill your pulpit. Now, our greeting this morning comes from the book of Revelation in the first chapter. Grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is a faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. As our God has greeted us, may we greet one another as well.
Good morning, everyone. One announcement before we go to our prayer. I noticed that we need a couple people to sign up for coffee for the next couple weeks. I know we're heading into the Labor Day weekend, but we don't have anybody signed up right now on the sheet for the next 2 weeks. So I would encourage you to look at your schedule and hopefully help us out with coffee serving as we really enjoy that part of our ministry here. As you all well know, Pastor Chris is under the weather. That's why we brought in Ryan this morning. I understand that they're healing up and doing well, and hopefully he'll be back ASAP to help us out here. Let's go to our Lord with our morning prayer. Dear Lord, we are so grateful for the opportunity to come here on this Sabbath morning to worship you, to lift up our praises to you. And we are so blessed to have this facility here and this church family to gather with here on Sunday morning. So we thank you for that. Bless our time of worship. May it be glorifying to you, Lord. Be with those in our church congregation that can't be with us this morning, whether they're not feeling well or they're traveling and away from us. May this Sabbath also be a blessing to them, wherever they may be. I pray a special request of healing this morning for Pastor Chris and his family. May they continue to recover and be back with us very soon. Also, thank you for the healing that's been experienced for that he took a fall on their vacation, but he's feeling better and his strength is coming back also. Thank you so much for the recovery that we've seen in as they continue to feel better and recover from the things that they've been through. I ask for prayers this morning for she's going to be traveling back from the Philippines this week. It was a blessing that she was able to get to her family in time for her sister's passing and that she's been able to spend that time with them, but I pray for safe travel for her as she returns. Also, safe travel for Pastor Paul and his family, as they will be coming back from South Korea in a short time. Prayers that their time over there has been good and fulfilling in his ministry and his training there and his connections that he's had to make there, but grant them safe travel as they come back to the States very soon also. Prayers also for who's been through quite an ordeal with his heart attack and his surgeries, and prayers for him to continue to get stronger and heal up, and prayers for she has to deal with all the logistics of all this stuff too. So thank you so much for that. Prayers also go out for this friend of our congregation who was assailed at the store here this week. It was kind of a bad situation where her purse was snatched and it ended up with some injuries. And so bless her as she recovers from those injuries. And also just from the trauma of dealing with that, such a crazy situation as that. I offer a prayer today for our school children as they begin school all throughout the counties around us. Schools re-engaging now as we approach Labor Day. Be with all the children and all the teachers and administrators as they begin the school programs. May they get off to a great start for the season. May you continue to bless our education system. Be with those that are in government and in charge of us, Lord, or the authorities over us. Grant them wisdom and guidance as they deal with so many different issues in this country, some very divisive and a lot of turmoil in this country, Lord. But I just pray for your hand to be in all of that and your guidance to be laid upon all of our leaders, local and national government leaders, Lord. Thank you again for all the blessings that you've bestowed on us here at Ideal Park. You've certainly blessed us. As we just sang, great is your faithfulness to us individually and as a church here, Lord. Thank you for bringing Ryan to us this morning. Bless the message that he's going to bring to us. Bless also our offerings that are about to be received. Again, you blessed us in so many ways, and that's just one way that we can show back our blessings back to the church family here, Lord, at Ideal Park through our offerings. So thank you for all the many blessings of healing, of church family here, and of just being able to come and worship you on this Sabbath morning. All this I pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. And we will now take that offering. The deacons will come forward, and our offerings are for general and... I forget what the other one was for. But anyway, the deacons will come on forward.
Morning, children. I'm glad you guys could come up here and spend a minute or two with me. Today we're going to look at a part of the Bible we call the Psalms. You ever heard of the Psalms before? The Psalms is, it's in the middle part of the Bible. And Jesus liked the Psalms very much. He used them a lot. And many of them were written by King David. You remember King David? So they were written by King David and other wise people. The 23rd Psalms is a very well-known one. Some people even memorize it. It goes like this. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, and your rod and staff, they comfort me. And so sometimes some people will memorize that and say it in times when they're feeling very stressed. So if you guys feel stressed sometime, you can look at the 23rd Psalm, and it'll help comfort you. Let's pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, and thank you for the Psalms which are written and help us to understand what you have in mind for us. We thank you, Lord, for your protection in times of trouble and the comfort that you give us through your word. In your name we pray these things. Amen.
Now, the passage this morning is from Hosea chapter 1, and they'll be on page 871 of your pew Bibles. And I invite you to open it up so that you may compare the words of my mouth to the very word of God. We are in Hosea chapter 1, page 871. Now, before we open up God's word, would you join me in a prayer? Our Heavenly Father, as we open up your holy word, may you open the eyes of our hearts to see what you have prepared for us in it. And as we go into your message, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be wholly pleasing to you. May you reveal to us what you want to reveal, and may you apply to us what you want to apply. We ask all of this trusting in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Hosea chapter 1, the whole chapter. The word of the Lord that came to Hosea, son of Beeri, during the reigns of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, and during the reign of Jeroboam, son of Jehoash, king of Israel. When the Lord began to speak through Hosea, the Lord said to him, "Go take to yourself an adulterous wife and children of unfaithfulness, because the land is guilty of the vilest adultery in departing from the Lord." So he married Gomer, daughter of Diblaim, and she conceived and bore him a son. Then the Lord said to Hosea, "Call him Jezreel, because I will soon punish the house of Jehu for the massacre at Jezreel, and I will put an end to the kingdom of Israel. In that day, I'll break Israel's bow in the valley of Jezreel." Gomer conceived again and gave birth to a daughter. Then the Lord said to Hosea, "Call her Lo-Ruhamah, for I will no longer show love to the house of Israel, that I should at all forgive them. Yet I will show love to the house of Judah, and I will save them, not by bow, sword, or battle, or by horses and horsemen, but by the Lord their God." After she had weaned Lo-Ruhamah, Gomer had another son. And the Lord said, "Call him Lo-Ami, for you are not my people, and I am not your God. Yet the Israelites will be like the sand on the seashore, which cannot be measured or counted. In the place where it was said to them, you are not my people, they will be called sons of the living God. The people of Judah and the people of Israel will be reunited, and they will appoint one leader and will come up out of the land, for great will be the day of Jezreel. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, before we delve too deeply into this passage of Hosea, it'd be very helpful for us to also lay some groundwork, some foundation, some historical context. There is a lot going on behind the scenes. So to jog our memories, if we go way back, we can remember that there was used to be one kingdom, and that it was given to Saul. There was one kingdom of Israel given to Saul. And because of the sins of Saul, it was given to David, who was a very good king. After David, it was given to his son, Solomon. And because of the sins of Solomon, the kingdom was divided into two. There was the northern kingdom, and there was the southern kingdom. The northern kingdom retained the name of Israel, and the southern kingdom took on the name Judah. Now, our letter is written to this northern kingdom, to this kingdom of Israel. We also have to have some historical context going on around also. Is this time in history when the Assyrian Empire was growing and near some of its largest extent? This means that the entire area, both Israel, Judah, all the way down to Egypt and all the kingdoms around, were all subjugated to Assyria, which means that there was actually relative peace. They were all paying taxes, they were all following Assyria, and Assyria, as long as they paid the taxes, let them do their own thing. And Assyria itself, its military, was way out on the other side of the empire, thousands and thousands of miles away, fighting. So there wasn't even much of a military presence. And what all of this means is that in Israel at the time, there was actually great prosperity. Because there was peace, because there was treaties and trade, there's money flowing all over the place. Israel was getting very wealthy. Or at least the hierarchy was. Those at the very top of the whole social pile were getting very wealthy. The royal families, the priests, the elders, those at the top. But they were oppressing those that were all on the bottom, all those who did not have that, all the poor. They were being taken advantage of. If you want to know a little bit more about that, you can read the prophet Amos, who was also sent to the kingdom of Israel. And he talked specifically about some of these social problems that were going on. But whenever there's societal and social problems, there's always spiritual problems as well. And that is what the prophet Hosea is addressing. You see, because of all this prosperity, all this well-being that Israel had, it had kind of gone spiritually astray. Why would it trust in God when it can easily just trade with its neighbors and make some monies here? Why worship God when, you know, it would increase trade and peace if you start worshiping this other god as well? Start putting your faith in the nations. Assyria will protect us, or Egypt will protect us, rather than in God alone. There is a spiritual chaos going on. The people are not trusting in God as their refuge and their strength. They're putting their faith into false gods, into dead gods, into the nations around them. And so, God gives them a visceral sign, a very uncomfortable sign to see. He asked Hosea to go marry a whore, a prostitute, an adulteress. The translations vary depending where you are. But the point is, she is an unfaithful wife. She's going after other men and not remaining with her husband, Hosea. And the image is very clear. The people of Israel are in the same place as Gomer. They are not being faithful to God. They're going all about having unfaithful children, producing unfaithful works. They're being involved with the nations and false gods. But if this visceral image of marrying a prostitute is not strong enough, God goes a step further. Gomer bears three children. And with each child, the punishment is ramped up. all three go together and they escalate into the final child. So let's take some time looking at these children, because often we can read their names and just kind of bypass and go through and go, wow, Israel must be in a bad spot. But that first child is named Jezreel. Now, even just hearing it when we read it, Jezreel and Israel sound very similar. They're even more similar in the original language. Which, on the one hand, shows the wordplay that the authors of the Bible enjoy, but it's also more important than just mere wordplay. The fact that they sound the same directly ties the kingdom and the people of Israel in with these children. What's happening to these children is going to happen to the people of Israel. So what's all this about Jehu? And what did he do that was so bad? Well, if we were to flip back into the books of the kings earlier in the Bible, we would find Jehu, who was a king. If perhaps you remember Ahab, a particularly bad king, and his wife Jezebel, who absolutely ruined the kingdom of Israel. Well, God appointed Jehu as the next king and said, go to Jezreel and put to death all of the family of Ahab. And so Jehu did that. He did all that he was asked to do. He got rid of the royal family. But then he went above and beyond, beyond what God told him to do. He went out and he killed all of the advisors of Ahab. And then he killed all of the friends of Ahab. And then some people from the kingdom of Judah were coming up to Israel to visit, and he killed them as well. He went way beyond what he was supposed to do, and he created a quick bloodbath. It's not unlike like Custer's Last Stand, where things just went totally awry all over the place. And just like Custer's Last Stand, it is a point of historical memory. Jehu's sin was so large that it was a mark on the entire people of Israel, which is why God brings it up here. Part of why that we put off and destroyed is because of Jehu. But Jezreel, just like most names, also has a meaning. And what Jezreel means is God scatters. So the point seems fairly clear. Because of the sins of Israel, because of the sins of Jehu, because of their unfaithfulness, the people will be scattered. And so we come to Gomer's second child, who is named Lo Ruhamah, or not loved, or not mercy, depending how we want to translate it. This is a fairly large condemnation. What this speaks to, this being not loved, this not showing mercy, is the warmth and care and favor that God gives will no longer belong to the people of Israel. They're not going to have God's favor. He's not going to care for them. He's not going to show them mercy. He is not going to love them. This is in contrast to the people of Judah, who God will continue to be faithful to. The people of Israel are to look south to Judah to see what they should be doing. The people will be scattered, and they'll be not shown mercy. And all of this escalates and sees its end in the third child, Lo Ami, not my people. I am not your God, and you are not my people. If the people are going to be scattered, if the people are not going to be shown the favor of God, it's clear that God is not viewing them as his own. This is a devastating condemnation. This means all of the promises given to the people of God, given to Abraham, are taken away from them. They will no longer be God's people. They are going to be just like everybody else, just like the Gentiles, just like the nations. God will not show them favor. God will not be with them. This is serious. These are words of absolute terror to whoever hears them, but it is the logical conclusion. Because of their unfaithfulness, the people are going to be scattered, not loved, and be as the Gentiles, not God's people. If this was where our passage ended this morning, that would be a very dark and depressing end. But thanks be to our God, that is not where he ends. He continues. And in the very place where he tells the Israelites, "You are not my people, I'm going to scatter you all over, and you will no longer receive my favor," he repeats the promise to Abraham. "They will be like the sand on the seashore, not measured nor counted." And what's more, they're not going to be brought back as some vague people group. They'll be brought back as the very children of the living God. And more than that, they're also going to be brought back into relation with Judah. They're going to have one king. There'll be one land. There'll be one people. This is good news for them to hear after all of that harsh condemnation. The passage does end with some glimmer of hope. It is not just mere and full wrath. But of course, the people had sinned. The people had been unfaithful. And if we know our history, they didn't turn back to God. And so what happened to them? Well, what happened was Israel made an alliance with the kingdom of Egypt. And together they're going to fight against the Assyrians to try and gain their independence. They thought they were strong enough and wealthy enough to fight a war against the largest empire at the time and become independent, no longer pay taxes to Assyria, be totally on their own. And so they prepared their military and they went to go fight Assyria. And well, how do you think that ended? It did not end well for them at all. In fact, what happened to them was the very prophecy of Hosea. They lost that war. They lost the battle with Assyria. And Assyria did what they always did with the people they conquered. They gathered them up and then scattered them across the rest of the empire. And then brought people from around the empire and settled them in this newly conquered land. The people were scattered. And in being scattered, they did not receive the favor of God. And in being scattered, they were made just like the nations, just like the Gentiles. They were scattered. They were not loved. And they were made to be not the people of God. This is a visceral image of Hosea and Gomer being mapped onto the relationship between God and Israel. And the biblical history shows that Israel did fall apart and they were cast off. But that's not the end of the image. This visceral image of unfaithfulness is actually paralleled with an even stronger image of faithfulness, of the faithfulness of Hosea, of the faithfulness of God. If you kept your Bibles open, please turn with me to chapter 3. "The Lord said to me, 'Go show your love to your wife again, though she is loved by another and is an adulteress. Love her as the Lord loves the Israelites, though they turn to other gods and love the sacred raisin cakes.' So I bought her for 15 shekels of silver and about a homer of a lethic of barley. Then I told her, 'You are to live with me many days. You must not be a prostitute or be intimate with any man, and I will live with you. For the Israelites will live many days without king or prince, without sacrifice or sacred stones, without ephod or idol. Afterward, the Israelites will return and seek the Lord their God and David their king. They will become trembling to the Lord and to his blessings in the last days.'" God is not quite done with the Israelites. They were unfaithful and they received that punishment, but there is still even more hope that is given here. if we were to fast forward all the way to the New Testament, what do you think happened to Israel and Judah? Well, perhaps you remember that there was this province of Judea. That's where most of the New Testament and the Gospels take place. Well, Judea roughly mapped onto the old kingdom of Judah. And what is directly north of Judea? We have Samaria. And who lives in Samaria? The Samaritans. Well, who are they? Well, this area of Samaria roughly overlaps with the old kingdom of Israel. The Samaritans are the descendants of those of Israel, those that were not scattered all over. And they were looked down upon by the Jews in Judea, and for good reason. These Samaritans were not exactly orthodox in their beliefs. They had intermarried with all the people the Assyrians had dropped into the area, and because of that, their faith and their religion also became this weird mix. It was not remotely faithful. But God was not done with these Samaritan people. He was not done with the people of Israel. We know that Jesus, on several occasions, went through Samaria. He preached. He healed. He worked among the Samaritans. And what happened? Some of them believed. We see the beginning of this reversal, the beginning of God's hope that he gave them in Hosea, seeing God's faithfulness. This is very clear in the first chapter of the book of Acts. Right before our Lord ascends up to heaven, he says, "You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth." It's being reversed. These Samaritans, if we go through the rest of Acts, start to believe. They are returned to the people of God. And not just as vague people, but as living children of a living God. These people are no longer shaped and defined by the blood that was shed in Jezreel by Jehu. They're now defined by the blood that was shed by their Savior, Jesus Christ. They're no longer not loved, not given mercy. They are loved. They are given mercy. They're brought back. Their sins are covered. And they're not God's people. They are fully brought back into his people, into his very family, to be living children after a living God. This is a fantastic reversal. It is great to see this. It is wonderful that we can see the works of God come to fruition. It's nice to see the Old Testament and the New Testament connect, but what does any of this actually mean for us? What does this mean for us today? What is this relationship between Hosea and Gomer and God and Israel mean for us today, this morning? Well, you and I also were grafted into the people of God, once far off and brought in. When we read through Scripture, what happens to Judah and Israel, that is our history as well. We are brought in to that very people and family of God. And so the lessons in there are also lessons for us. They're also lessons for us to learn from, to look at, and apply to our own lives. And it's this unfaithfulness and faithfulness that I would like us to look at a little bit this morning in relation to the church. Now, there are two lessons that I would like us to focus on. The first one has to do with the church as a whole, as a community of believers. Those of us here at Ideal Park, those of us in the wider West Michigan area, in the CRC, and then all denominations all over, all the people of God. We must ask ourselves, are we faithful or are we unfaithful? Are we going the way of Israel or are we remaining faithful to our God? This is actually a very real question we have to ask. It's very easy for us to just gloss over it and say, oh no, of course we're faithful. We're not like that church down the road that prays to statues and has all kinds of pictures that they pray to and venerate. We're not like those churches. Or we might, as a denomination, say, oh, we just passed a sexuality report. We are a good and orthodox denomination. And praise be to our God for both of those things, but the problem is much deeper than that. We can't just gloss over that easily. A quick glance at any of the numbers surrounding church attendance and belief will cause many of us some dismay, especially those of us that stand behind pulpits. We know that church attendance is going down. Less and less people are attending churches. We know that belief is also on a downward trajectory. Many still claim to believe, but they know virtually nothing. Maybe the occasional Bible story, something about Jesus, but their beliefs about God, who he is and what he's done, are fading. And it's easy for us to see this and then try and come up with ways to solve it. How are we going to get people back into the church? How are we going to bring people in? It's a very real and good question, but the ways that we do it can show unfaithfulness to God. We might find a particularly gifted speaker, a very gifted minister, and form a church, a movement, an entire denomination around one man, not the Word of God. We may simply just try and say, oh, the easiest way to grow the church is to just have many, many children. And we'll do that. We'll grow the church just by having many children. And now both of these may work, but are we being faithful to God in doing them? Most perniciously, what I believe goes under goes undetected very often is our relationship with the world. Quite often, churches may try and dress up their church to look like the world, to act like the world. They'll say things like, we're all things to all people, just like Paul, or we're winning people to Christ at any cost. But the church cannot play nice with the world. It does not work that way. Israel played with the world, with the nations. They made allegiances. They tried to play nice, following the ways of the world and the nations and their gods, and also pay lip service to God. But where did that end them? How did that end up? They ended up scattered, unloved, and not the people of God. No, we can't just simply play nice with the world. We cannot invite the world into the church, dress up our churches like the world. We know the past 2 months ago, there were churches that were flying flags off their windows to celebrate Pride Month. There were churches over the past several weeks and months that have come out in favor, official church statements in favor of the murder of unborn children. They may think that doing this will bring people into the church and help them to become faithful believers, but in reality, when they play with the world, they become like the world. It is not going to end the way they think it will. We must be cautious to not play with the world, or we'll end up like Israel. Now, every church, every community is also made up of individuals. That's you and me, people like you and me. So we have to also ask the same questions we ask of the church to ourselves. Are we faithful? Do we trust and fear God? I'll answer for myself. I know that I definitely do not. And I trust that if you're honest with your own hearts, you'll come to a similar conclusion. We tend to trust in all sorts of things. We trust in our investments, our networks, our social circles, our education, our friends, anything other than God alone. As individuals, we too can also be unfaithful. And if you remember the story of Jericho, All it took was one man, Achan, to not follow God, and it caused damage to the entire people. But of course, that's not the end of the story. God was not done with Israel. He brought them back. Hosea was not done with Gomer. He brought her back. And our God is not done with us or our churches. He brings us back as well. Because we live in a time after Christ, after the death and resurrection, where all of the sins of Israel, all of their unfaithfulness was pinned on Christ and he died for it. Where all of the unfaithfulness, all of the adultery of Gomer were pinned on Christ and he died for it. And all of the sins of our church, our denomination, are pinned on Christ and he died for it. All the sins of you and me are pinned on Christ and he died for it. And then he rose again to give new life. You see, we do not live in a time of God's wrath and judgment. We live in a time of God's mercy, of God's love, of God bringing his people to himself, bringing them back. He is faithful, even as we are not. As churches, we may go astray for a time, but God is faithful even if we are not. As individuals, we might go all over the place, but God will bring us back. We may be scattered, unloved, not God's people for some time, but God always brings his people back. And so to close, if you are astray this morning, if you know that you are far off from God, repent, return to God. He will take you back every time. As a church, let us be cautious. Let us evaluate everything we seek to do to grow, to engage with the world through the lens of Scripture that God has given us. Let us strive to be faithful. Let's pray for our denomination, the Christian Reformed Church. Let us pray for all the churches in Grand Rapids, West Michigan, around the world, that we may, as a whole, be faithful to God. Because the times are difficult. The church is struggling. But our God is faithful. But if nothing else, please find rest in the assurance and the knowledge that you are a child of the living God, that you have been taken from the death of sin and brought into the life of grace. If nothing else, rest in the assurance that God is faithful and he always brings you back. Amen. Will you join me in prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the story of Hosea and Gomer. It's not an easy one to read or to even think through. But we are thankful for the image that it shows us, that you are a faithful God despite anything and everything we or others may do. You brought the people of Israel back to yourself. You cleaned them off in Jesus Christ and you made them your living children. No longer will they serve the dead gods and the wayward nations, but they will serve you and you alone. We know that is also true for us. You found us when we were deep in sin, and you loved us before we ever knew you, and you died for our sins, and you rose to new life to give us new life as well, that we may have our life in you, in the full knowledge that you are making us truly alive, working in us to put off all that is unfaithful. We thank you for all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.